Dawns and sunsets of all colors, celestial bodies with ever-changing speeds, masses, shapes, and volumes. Environments mostly hostile to life, and very dark skies where large and small moons move, with nights that last months or a few hours, or where the sun can suddenly reverse its apparent motion. All this is our solar system. Also, in this third and last part of our journey, we will try to put together science and imagination, visiting skies completely alien to our experiences as inhabitants of planet Earth. Just as we did for Jupiter, we will have to imagine Saturn somehow floating above its clouds to be able to see what is happening in its sky. And if we could really do that, we would probably see it slowly fade from the blue of the high atmosphere to the black of the surrounding space. The composition of Saturn's atmosphere is in fact similar to that of Jupiter, with a prevalence of molecular hydrogen and helium. Seen from there, the Sun is about 100 times less bright than it appears from the Earth, and its disk with an angular diameter of just 3.4 arc minutes, from those distances begins to be appreciable with difficulty. As well as you can see with difficulty, the Earth, which still shines like a star of second magnitude, but is separated from the Sun a little more than 6 degrees. The larger moons of Saturn, although less conspicuous than those of Jupiter, form an overall necklace of remarkably luminous objects. In order of magnitude, Titan, Rhea, Dione, Tetis, Enceladus, and Mimas. The apparent dimensions speak to us of satellites at most half the size of our moon, but it is also true that 6 of them, those we have listed, have an apparent brightness around magnitude -7, or on average 5 to 10 times brighter than Venus seen from Earth. Remarkable are the cases of Enceladus and Tetis, which, thanks to a very high albedo, their surfaces are absolutely white. Exceeded in brightness even the great Titan, 5,150 kilometers in diameter. Can you imagine the spectacle we could enjoy at the sight of these 6 moons, bright as headlights, turning in the night sky of Saturn, accompanied by the overflowing beauty of the rings that form the background? Yes, because by far the most spectacular element of Saturn's sky is obviously that of the rings. An element that, if fascinates, seen from the outside, must be even shocking if observed from somewhere on the planet, from where you would see the entire sky crossed by an iridescent arc. The rings become more and more conspicuous as the latitude increases, and consequently the angle under which they are observed. Seen from the equator, they are instead practically invisible because of their incredible subtlety. During the equinoxes, which happen about every 14 years, the Sun hits the cutting rings, and consequently the shadow they cast on the planet is minimal. But far from the equinoxes, the rings cast complex and very wide shadows on Saturn. To be able to observe from the high atmosphere of the planet, or from some of its many moons, the alternation of shadows and lights on the underlying cloud systems must be an extraordinary suggestive view. A view that we can say we know well thanks to the interplanetary probes that have visited the planet. Especially thanks to Cassini, who for years wandered around the planet's satellite system, photographing incredible cosmic landscapes, where moons and rings gave life to geometric shapes of unique beauty. The great Titan, which has even planetary dimensions, could be in the future an excellent observation point for the first human explorers. But unfortunately, Titan is also the only satellite in the solar system to have a dense atmosphere, so dense that it probably obstructs any kind of astronomical observation. Saturn would be invisible behind the orange smog curtain, and even the Sun would be just a lighter spot in the mist, barely illuminating the surface of the ice and methane lakes. The images sent to Earth by the Huygens probe show that Titan's sky is a light mandarin color. However, an astronaut on the surface would perceive a brown or dark orange color. As a result of its greater distance from the Sun and the opacity of its atmosphere, the surface of Titan receives only about 1/1000th of the Earth's sunlight. The day on Titan is therefore only as bright as twilight on Earth. However, in the upper atmosphere, the sky would have a blue color and Saturn would be visible. 10 astronomical units beyond Saturn, we come across Uranus, another gas giant, but 2.4 times smaller in size than the Lord of the Rings. The Sun seen by Uranus really begins to look like a point of light without dimension, only 1.6 arc minutes angular diameter and a brightness that is just 1/400th of the one that reaches the Earth. From a distance of almost 20 AU, the inner planets of the solar system from Mercury to Mars are now lost in the radiance of the star, and it makes no sense to consider them for observational purposes. Uranus is not a hospitable place, also without a solid surface, with winds blowing up to 900 kilometers per hour. It is the coldest planet of the solar system, with an average temperature of minus 220 degrees Celsius. Yet Uranus also has its fascinating peculiarities. First of all, the rotation axis of the planet is inclined by 98 degrees on the orbital plane. The rotation appears, therefore, retrograde, like that of Venus. But unlike Venus, which rotates upside down, Uranus is lying on its side, as if it rolled along its orbit. Because of this peculiarity, the climate and landscape change in a completely different way compared to other planets. At the poles of Uranus, the day and night are very long. They last 42 Earth years, although with different shades of darkness and light. The only periods in which sunlight is directed mainly towards the equatorial zones is during the equinoxes, which fall every 42 years. And it is only on horseback of the equinoxes that Uranus sees an alternation of day and night marked by its period of rotation of 17 hours. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell. You will help us to make products of even higher quality. Uranus also has a complex system of rings, which is, however, extremely soft and not very bright. So it is not certain that from above the atmosphere of the planet against a sky, probably aquamarine colored for the presence of methane, it is possible to see it. Also for Uranus, the show comes from its moons, the largest of which, thanks to their reduced distance from the planet, would appear to us in the form of disks not much smaller than that of our moon, and with brightness such as to transform even the sky of Uranus into a racetrack of lights that chase each other relentlessly. Apart from the classic satellites, Ariel, Titania, Oberon, Umbriel, Miranda, which range from 500 to 1500 kilometers in diameter, what is surprising is to see that even small but very close satellites, such as Portia, Juliet, or Puck, all on the 100 kilometers, sometimes show themselves with an angular diameter and brightness really important. All of them are, however, locked in a one-to-one resonance and always show the same face to the planet. From the sky of Uranus, all the other planets seem to have disappeared, even the biggest ones. From Uranus, Jupiter shines like an opaque second-magnitude star, and Saturn even as a third-magnitude star. Barely visible to the naked eye is Neptune, the planet we are about to visit. Neptune, the planet discovered in 1846 by the mathematical calculation, travels in the depths of the solar system, covering its orbit in about 165 Earth years and a distance of 30 astronomical units from the Sun. At such a distance, the sunlight is 1,000 times less intense than the one that hits the Earth, while the angular diameter of our star is reduced to a little more than one arc minute. Yet this giant of gas and ice, due to an unknown source of internal heat, is hotter than Uranus, although it is much further away from the Sun. And this internal heat unleashes on Neptune the most powerful winds of the solar system. If you were in the high atmosphere of the planet, you could observe spectacular whirlpool systems that travel at supersonic speed, sometimes exceeding 2,000 kilometers per hour. The planet is surrounded by at least 27 moons, most of them small and asymmetrical, with dimensions of 100 to 200 kilometers, but almost all of them so close to the planet to appear to a hypothetical observer with angular dimensions just under half of our lunar disk. Even their brightness, despite the reduced illumination coming from the Sun, is maintained at such a level, the brightness of Venus observed from the Earth, that even on that icy and gloomy planet there is a very varied and busy sky. Obviously, the superstar of that satellite system is Triton, the seventh largest of the entire solar system. After Titan, our moon and the four Medicians, and the only one among the greats to move along a retrograde orbit. It always shows the same face to Neptune, who therefore occupies a fixed position, or almost, in its sky, showing itself with an apparent diameter of 8 degrees. On the contrary, in the sky of Neptune, Triton would instead show itself to our eyes with the same angular dimensions as our moon, and at the same distance. The only difference would be in the brightness, 250 times lower. Without forgetting that even Neptune, like the other gas giants, has a system of rings, probably of recent formation and certainly inconspicuous, because of the scarce light they receive from the Sun and the reddish color due to the charcoal materials mixed with ice from which they are composed. No possibility to appreciate them with the naked eye. Not even sharpening our gaze as we move away in the direction of Pluto, the last destination of this long journey. Pluto? Yes. Although almost 15 years have already passed since its downgrading to dwarf planet, we don't feel like excluding good old Pluto from our tour among the planets of the solar system. Also because the visit made by the New Horizon probe has shown beyond any reasonable doubt that Pluto has all the characteristics of a real planet. A double planet even. Yes, because 20,000 kilometers away from Pluto, there is also Charon, a giant moon compared to the size of the primary planet. As we know, the two bodies rotate around a common center of mass and always turn to each other the same hemisphere. Possible how much improbable inhabitants situated on the hidden faces of the two objects would not know, therefore never of the reciprocal existence. The inhabitants of the visible face of Charon would see Pluto, which has a diameter of about 2,300 kilometers, looming in their sky with an angular diameter of 7.3 degrees, equal to 15 times that of the full moon seen from Earth. Charon instead, which has a diameter of 1,200 kilometers, would appear in Pluto's sky with an angular diameter of 3.7 degrees, about 7 times that of the full moon. Surely it would be possible to see distinctly with the naked eye from Pluto the superficial characteristics of Charon, and vice versa, even if the whole landscape would appear immersed in a light more than twilight because of the great distance from the sun. Pluto and Charon, together with the other very small moons of the system, run a very elliptical orbit, which lasts 248 Earth years. The distance from the sun varies between 4.4 billion kilometers to the perihelion and the abyss of more than 7.3 billion kilometers to the aphelion. At such enormous distances, the sun appears very small. On average, a little more than one arc minute at perihelion, a 13th of the apparent size that it has in the terrestrial sky, and 35 arc seconds at aphelion. The brightness of our star in the sky of Pluto and Charon is consequently equally reduced, 1/876th of what we see from Earth, when the twin planets are at the minimum distance, just 1/2430th when they are at the maximum distance. We must not think, however, that such a tiny and distant sun implies a perennial night. The sun, in fact, illuminates the two icy bodies with a light that is still almost 500 times greater than that of the full moon in the night sky of the Earth. In 2015, New Horizons gave us extraordinary images of these two remote worlds, revealing the unthinkable existence of truly alien skies right on the edge of our solar system. You can check out the first two episodes of Alien Skies, The Universe Seen by Mercury, Venus and the Moon, and the universe seen by Mars and Jupiter on the Insane Curiosity channel.